What's up, geeks, and welcome to the channel. In this video, we are going to lay out several methods provided by the Java API to read and write from a given resource or a file. We are also going to see how these methods and features evolved across different versions. In addition to this, and to follow up on previous videos, I'm going to throw in the Java transient keyword at the end, because it just fits so well with the examples we are going to give. So let's get started. If you have ever written or read anything from a file using Java, you probably have made use of the FileReader and FileWriter classes, which are part of the Java I/O package. These classes are the classic way we read and write to a file in Java. All we have to do is instantiate them, specify the path or name of the file we want to read from or write to, and then use respectively the read or write methods. We can also pass a boolean to the write method to specify whether we want to append to the file the data we are passing or overwrite its existing content with it. You may have noticed that the default read method of the FileReader class only reads one character at a time, as shown in the second try with resources code snippet. Therefore, to read more than one character at once, we have to use its overloaded version, which takes the exact number of characters we are trying to read, as shown in the third try with resources. At this point, we can pretty much agree that it is kind of a hassle to do this. That is why most of the time when we use these two classes, we tend to wrap them with both the BufferedReader and the BufferedWriter. But why do we do that? Why do we have to decorate them with these two classes? And how does this solve our issue? Well, to really know the aim behind this, just think of a YouTube video, and how the actual video gets buffered while watching to allow a flawless experience without having to wait for the video at any point in time. Well, that is exactly what these buffer classes are doing. They are providing a buffer for the FileReader and FileWriter. You see, both the FileReader and FileWriter objects process 2 to 4 bytes at a time. That's really slow, right? What if I want to print a single line, not just the couple bytes ahead of my current position? And most importantly, I want to stop worrying about the number of characters I need. Well, the BufferedReader in this case will store the bytes read by the FileReader in a special memory place on the RAM, called buffer, and when the FileReader hits a forward slash n or an end of line, then the BufferedReader will return the desired output stored in this buffer to the user. That is why when we wrap the FileReader with a BufferedReader, we will have access to a bunch of new methods, one of them being the readLine method we are using in this example. We won't be limited to the use of the read method, which reads data one character at a time. In JDK 4, Java and I/O was introduced, or non-blocking I/O, as it performs non-blocking operations. These operations rely heavily on buffers and channels. For instance, a thread or process can ask a channel to read certain data from a buffer, and in the meantime, until the data is ready, go do something else, hence the non-blocking notation. Most importantly, this data is being read from a buffer, not from a file or resource directly, as it was cached here. So upon need, we can move back and forth to this data, which maximizes the overall efficiency. The core components of the Java and I/O package are buffers, channels, and selectors. Channels read data into a buffer or from a buffer. They act as a medium or gateway between our buffers and data. Selectors, on the other hand, monitor multiple channels for events. They are used to select which channel will be used to perform the next I/O operation requested by the user. There are a lot of ways to read and write to a file using the NIO package. Let's look up a few. First, to write data to a file, we can use the files.write method and provide it with a path to our file. It also allows for further customization, such as the create option to create the file if it doesn't exist the first time we try to write to it, and the append option to append the data to it instead of overriding existing data. We can also specify the char set or format of the data we are trying to read or write to this file, in our case UTF-8. On the other hand, if we want, for example, to read the whole file, we have the option to do that as an array of bytes and use the readAllBytes method. The array of bytes can be converted to a string using a string constructor to get the actual data we are looking for, as we are doing in the first part of our code snippet. Another way to do it is to create a new BufferedReader also using the files class and pass to it the path of our file. And here we return to exactly the same spot we were in when using the BufferedReader class. We can choose to get all the lines at once like we are doing in this example, or one by one as we did previously. We can also use the NIO package to read from our resources folder using a combination of the class loader class and files.line method. In our example, the stream of strings returned is directly printed out to the console. Nothing fancy here. Some of the methods present inside the NIO package were introduced later and weren't present in its initial version, like the files.line method we are using right here, which returns a stream. Well, the stream package itself was introduced in Java 8, so yeah. The latest change related to reading or writing to a file was introduced in Java 11, with the files.readstring and files.writestring methods. They make it very easy to read small files into a string object directly and vice versa. And here you can see how these methods are actually used in Java. Now, as I said at the beginning of the video, I am also going to cover the use of the transient keyword in Java. And while doing so, we will also see other ways to read and write to a file in Java. To do this, let's take the following class as an example. This class has 5 attributes, some are transient, some aren't, and the main method. Inside this method, you can kind of distinguish 2 categories. The serialization part, where we write these attributes or the whole object to a file, and the deserialization part, where we read these same attributes or this object from the same file. The file input stream and file output stream we are using here are also the classic way of reading and writing data to a file and are part of the Java I/O package. In our case, we are writing an object to the file and are reading the same object from the file. That is why we are wrapping the file output and file input stream with the object output and object input stream. After instantiating our stream objects, we went ahead and made use of the write object and read object methods. These functions will persist the state of the object passed as argument or its attributes to the file we just mentioned. Finally, at the end of each section, the serialization and the deserialization, we are printing to the console the object attributes. Actually, to be able to print these results or the variables we serialized and deserialized, we went ahead and overrode the toString method. Now, if we try and run this application, the output will be as follows. As you can see, the first 2 variables that do not have the transient keyword were retrieved correctly, but the third attribute, which is an integer, was assigned to its default value, a 0. And that's because it is marked as transient. This keyword indicates that a variable is not part of the persistent state of an object, or the default serialized form of an object. So when an object is serialized or written into a persistent storage, in our case a file, only the values of its non-transient instance fields, in this example the first 2 fields, are included in its default serial representation. And when an object is deserialized, transient fields are initialized to their default value, like the third attribute in the give we had. However, when transient is used with the static or final keyword, it has no impact and produces no compilation errors. In our case, the 4th and 5th variables. The thing is that static fields are part of the class and represent its state, and the transient keyword operates only at the object's state level. Furthermore, final fields are directly serialized by their initial value, as they aren't allowed to be reinitialized. So, that's it for this video. I hope it was helpful. Thank you guys for watching. Take care, and I will see you in the next one.